Welcome everyone, I'm so happy that you are here this evening. This is our last concert of the Hillman Visiting Artists series for this year. I hope you'll join us again next year when we bring back some of the great artists from around the world. It's a program that I'm really proud of. And I'm really excited about tonight's program because I have the most beautiful Sarah Sandbrojo here. She's a fabulous cellist. I love when people just talk about you behind your back like this. She's a fantastic cellist, and she has many things that she is famous for, but probably the most famous is that she is the cellist with the Eroica Piano Trio, Grammy Award-winning, toured all over the world. There is not a place that she hasn't played, right? Is there a place that you haven't played the Frank and Sue Maybourne Performing Arts Center before? We are really excited to have her, so I'm sure you will enjoy her immensely. We have three composers on tonight's program. Tonight's program is a slightly shortened version of a program that we are going to be doing in Austin on Friday night and Saturday night. And all three composers, while they're very different in the way that they compose music, they all have some similarities as well. First of all, they all have birthdays within the same, within like 2 weeks of each other. So it's another birthday concert. We like those, right? And all of the composers were incredibly obsessed with melody. They loved creating melodies and expanding melodies and like changing melodic form and function in their own time. In fact, you're going to find that they love melodies so much that they put melodies on top of one another. And we're often competing with really good melodies against each other, so you'll have to decide which melody you like the best at the same time. Really, these composers were obsessed with that idea. And they were also incredibly elegant composers, both in their own personal stature, the way they held themselves. They were crafted their pieces in really incredible ways. And they all had a thing about them. And I think you're going to be able to feel that thing. Ravel's really French impressionistic voice is so perfumey, and he really tries to make the piano sound like a different instrument, the cello like a different instrument, really embodying these colors. With Chopin, he was a Polish nationalist, and he loved the Polish style, and throughout, even though he writes a sonata, it's Polish folk music at its best. And then Piazzolla was the father of the, he wasn't the father, he was more like the son of the tango, and he took tango, traditional tango, to a new realm with Nuevo Tango, so very passionate and very forthright music. So we'll start with the Ravel, and this was an early work of Ravel's, but it didn't get published until after his death. And it's actually a sonata that was written for violin and piano, but it's so special that many cellists steal it.
Igor Stravinsky has a line that I really like as a cellist, because he wrote, "Good artists borrow, great artists steal." And cellists steal more than any other instrument. Because the range of our instrument is so unbelievably wide, we can really pretty easily, if you're not worried about like the altitude and lack of oxygen up in the stratosphere, you can steal most violin pieces. And I actually have an entire album of Chopin where all but two pieces were stolen from the piano. And I think, I hate to say it, and
don't say it.
But I think it sounds every bit as good, if not better, on the cello. I do think that the cello just makes everything better. But the thing also that I love about each one of these composers is that they were real iconoclasts. When Ravel was one of the first progenitors of the French Impressionist style. And before that, that German compositional tradition really reigned supreme, where everything was so detailed. And in the French Impressionist style of music, like in the art, it's more about the gestures and the colors that you create. And you hear the melodies, but they're almost inferred in many ways, as opposed to, you know, explicitly plotted out for you. And I think there's something so beautiful about it, because I can just, when I close my eyes, I just see these colors washing across the music, and it's just fantastic. And we'll talk about the Chopin before we play it, but he was also a iconoclast as well.
Ready to hear some music?
Thank you.
About me behind my back. I really appreciate that. And that was the first time that Michelle has ever played this piece, which I thought was pretty amazing. It's students here. And I know that when I was a student, I felt like every single concert I did, I had to be perfect or I'd never get another chance. And when I was 17, I heard that there were a number of cellists in the St. Louis Symphony who were had injured themselves and they needed extra players for the summer. And I needed to make money during the summer between school. And so I auditioned and got the job. And I didn't realize that in the summer, they did a lot of light classics that they all had played a million times. So the only thing they would rehearse was the concerto with the soloist. So I would be sight reading these pieces on stage in the concert. So, and my dad, luckily, was principal cello of the St. Louis Symphony. And so he would sometimes, like at dinner, give me a heads up and say, "Oh, that's Smetana, Bard and Bride. Quite tricky sometimes the first time. You might want to get there a little early." So, but he didn't. One day we were playing Tchaikovsky 1812 Overture. Now, I know this doesn't sound possible, but I had never heard the piece before. I had no idea how it went, and I had no idea what the instrumentation was. So I'm sitting in the back of the cello section, and I'm playing it. It's really fun, and I'm really doing well. I'm feeling very proud of myself. And we get to this really tricky running note passage, and I'm in the zone, like, you know, totally focused. I'm just nailing it. And all of a sudden, a cannon goes off behind me. And I was not expecting that on a stage. And so, of course, I did what anyone would do when a cannon goes off behind you. I stood up and screamed as loud as I could in the concert. And then I realized, oh my gosh, and I sat right back down. I was like, oh no. And so I looked over at my stand partner, who's this very, very serious Japanese gentleman, and he did not look at me. And I was like, oh my gosh. But somehow the conductor had not seen it. And of course my dad didn't, because he was way up in the front, sitting in the front chair. So I get back into the piece, and I'm mortified, but I'm like, no, I'm a performer. Don't think in the past, think forward. So I'm thinking forward. And then, lo and behold, we come up to a very similar section, like the last one when that stupid cannon went off. But now I'm like, good, because I was really nailing it before that stupid cannon went off, and so I get a second chance of really nailing it. Never thinking that last time I was doing this, the cannon went off. So, of course, I'm in it, I'm totally in the zone, I'm nailing it, and the cannon goes off again. And I stand up and scream again. And this time, I'm so mortified, I just stand there, like for a few seconds because I was like, my career is over. That's it. I haven't even. I'm 17, and I might as well just like go back to regular school and figure out another major. And I sit down, and I'm just so mortified. And I see that my stand partner is shaking with rage. He's so upset with me. And then I see that he's actually laughing. And not only that, but all the brass players had seen me do it both times. And so now they're laughing as they're playing. And slowly but surely, the whole orchestra starts to fall apart. All because of me. And I'm like, this is it. Not only am I going to like never have a career, but I'll be banned from every concert for the rest of my life. And I get back in, and I keep my head down, and I play as best as I can, and as I'm walking off the stage, but also miraculously, again, the conductor did not see me. I think God was watching over me for sure. And so I'm walking off the stage, and I'm trying to be very quiet as I start to pass the conductor. And the conductor, for some reason, at that moment, turns around and claps me on the back and says, Sarah, I'm just so impressed with how professional you've been. And one of the trumpet players says, oh boy, this orchestra would not sound the same without her professionalism. So I did discover that you can make a giant fool out of yourself, but if you try your hardest, you can recover. And that if you can recover from that, you can recover from anything. The next piece that we're going to play for you is by Friedrich Chopin. Chopin was such an extraordinary composer and also an iconoclast. When he was waging his career, the real pianists of the day were Franz Liszt, these superhuman virtuoso powerhouses who played like, you know, basically they could break glasses with the volume of their sound and their unbelievable pyrotechnics of their technique. And Chopin was never weighed more than 100 pounds in his entire life. He was very sickly. And so he was not that kind of virtuoso. While he had unbelievable technique, as Robert Schumann said when he heard a concert of his, he wrote a letter to Brahms and said, I just heard the most extraordinary pianist and composer, Friedrich Chopin. He's a Pole, and I think I never heard so many gradations of five pianissimos, four pianissimos, three pianissimos, and once he actually reached piano. But what he would do, instead of doing what a lot of composers did at the time to express more passion, he would get louder. But what he would do would be add notes to the melody, as if he was adding Christmas tree ornaments onto the tree. The tree is a beautiful tree, but then he would add more and more and more notes to make it even more passionate and not more volume, which becomes extremely tricky for the performers because it's just, there's notes coming out of your ears. Yeah, it's just crazy how difficult this piece is for both of us. And this is his last major work that he wrote before he died, and he really slaved over it. And he had so many ideas, as Michelle alluded to earlier. He had so many melodies and so many ideas that you're often playing two unbelievably beautiful melodies, but simultaneously, and sometimes it's difficult for the listener to decide who should I listen to. But what I feel like with Chopin is what he does is it's like he takes his heart and then he hands it to you, the listener, and says, here, can you take care of this for me? And so I like to sit back and just let the beauty and the vulnerability and the fragility and the passion wash over me.
Thank you. Thank you.
Piazzolla. And while he wasn't the inventor of the tango, he was the legitimizer of it. It was a mixture of all the immigrant groups that went to this very international port harbor city of Buenos Aires in Argentina. And so actually the tango almost always will have it would have a bandoneon, which is like a small accordion, which actually came from the German marching band. And then African rhythms because of all the African slaves that were brought over, and then Italian and Spanish as well. There was a huge Italian population in Argentina. Still, to this day, half the people are Italian, of Italian heritage. And so Piazzolla grew up hearing this, and he's the one who sort of basically wrote it down and sort of made it the new tango so it would be acceptable for the concert hall. And it just took off and became one of the most popular music forms and dance forms in the world. And this, the first piece we're gonna play for you is actually a milonga, which was the popular song form of the Pampas, of the plains. It's called Oblivion. And it is, I think, one of the most beautiful melodies I've ever heard in my life. There's so much longing, and it's just so beautiful that when I first learned it, I learned it in a trio version with my trio, and every single night, it would just be going in my head all night long, and I really just didn't feel like I was getting a good night's sleep because this soundtrack was just going in my head, and I was having all kinds of, disturbing dreams, and I just kept thinking I was some Spanish woman in Argentina or something. It was crazy. And so then I arranged it for cello and piano, which is what Michelle and I are going to do. And I thought that would help, but it didn't. And so then I arranged it for cello and orchestra, and then I finally was able to let me have peace and get some sleep. And in fact, after the concert, we'd love to come out and meet with you. And I actually have both the Oblivion and the next tango that we're going to play, Liber Tango. I recorded them with orchestra. I actually have an old Chopin recording. I have recordings with Chopin on them, with other pieces, and then also the Latin Dreams. So they're for sale if you would like them. But anyway, I hope you'll stay and say hi so we get to meet you all and chat a bit. And then the second tango that we're going to play is an actual tango. It's called Liber Tango, and it is probably his most famous tango. To his chagrin, actually, because he was forced to write it as a way to celebrate the fascist dictatorship in Argentina, which he was very much against, and he didn't want to write it. But when he did finally write it, he infused it with all the joy and the passion for freedom and for humanity that he felt was missing in Argentina at that time. And I think that is why it has become so popular, because human beings all over the world feel those same emotions and they recognize it in the music. It's interesting, my trio, in 1997, were the first American classical group to go to Vietnam and perform after the war. And they were very specific with us that we could not play any French music and we could not play any American music. We could only play German or Russian. And we happened to have a hit record right then, which was all French and American. And so we were, Gershwin. So what we did is, as an encore, we played the third prelude of Gershwin's, which is just so full of joy and life and freedom. And it was so interesting because the moment we sat down and started playing, I could see the cultural minister running around backstage trying to figure out a way to stop us. But the second we finished playing, the audience went insane. And it was all Vietnamese, and outside they had erected these 100-foot screens and speakers, and sort of thousands of people sitting outside just in the road on their bicycles watching the concert, and you could hear them screaming outside afterwards. And it was being live broadcast on television, and the television reporter asked me as I was walking off, what was that last piece? And I just loved it, it was so great. And I said, oh, that was a very well-known American composer, George Gershwin. And she was like, George Gershwin, never heard of him. But they loved it, they just responded to it, because human beings respond to music because it's the universal language. It's all about our emotions and what we feel and what we want for ourselves and for our children. And that's one of the most greatest gifts that my career has given me, is that I have been able to travel all over the world. And wherever I go, it's not like I'm corporate rating, you know? I'm bringing a beauty that everyone can understand. And it's been such a gift. I'm so blessed. I'm so grateful. So Lieber Tango is this. We're going to play Oblivion first, and then Lieber Tango. And I always felt like Lieber Tango, I sort of feel like it's a celebration of humanity, and I feel, when I play the cello, I feel closer to God than I feel in anywhere else. And so I wrote a cadenza to start the piece, and it's almost like a prayer for humanity. So this is Oblivion and Lieber Tango by Astor Piazzolla.